السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: اعلموا أنما الحياة الدنيا لعب ولهو وزينة وتفاخر بينكم وتكاثر في الأموال والأولاد، كمثل غيث أعجب الكفار نباته ثم يهيج فتراه مصفرا ثم يكون حطاما، وفي الآخرة عذاب شديد ومغفرة من الله ورضوان، وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher and protector. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, first and foremost, it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous blessings and bounties that He has bestowed upon us. Every single thing that we look around us is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Basically, we are wallowing in the ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we look around the numerous factors, whether it be around us or within ourselves, every single thing is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if they be positive or negative. And when we say negative, even the calamities, the disasters, even the diseases that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through, are a blessing and a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to highlight on that, a good example would be for a negative situation being a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a beautiful story of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. As we all know, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, one of the greatest prophets, our grandfather of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa salam, he and his beloved wife Sarah alayhi salatu wa salam, they were traveling from Palestine, they were crossing over the border of Misr, the border of Egypt. So whilst they were crossing this particular border, the king who used to rule Egypt was a corrupt king. He was an evil person. So he had a habit of abducting the women of the people who used to cross the borders and use them for evil purposes. So when Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he reached the border of Egypt and he was about to cross it, now he comes to know of this particular king and now he's worried. Because you come to the border and you've got soldiers there blocking the place. And they question Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam as to who this woman next to you is. Now the king, another thing is that he only used to kidnap or abduct women who are other men's wives. If you say that she is your sister or your mother, he's going to leave you alone. So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam at this particular juncture, he said a statement saying that she is my sister. It may look as if it's a lie, but what he had in his own heart was that she is my sister in Islam. Why? Because he wanted to repel the evil and he was saying this for the greater good. There are three such statements of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, which we will perhaps discuss later on. But at this juncture, he said that she is my sister in Islam. So still, scholars mention that Sarah alayhi salatu wasalam was a woman who was indeed extremely beautiful. She was a very beautiful lady. So the soldiers, the minute they saw her, they knew that, you know, the king would be interested in, you know, seeing this lady. So they said, even if she be your sister, we have to take her to the palace of the king. And they took her by force. Now at this moment, you can just imagine the emotional turmoil Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam must have been going through. His own wife, his beloved wife, being kidnapped by a king. He does not know what harm would befall upon her. So at that very moment, and there's another lesson to be learned from Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he immediately turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He immediately goes into prayer. And the soldiers take Sarah alayhi salatu wasalam towards the king's palace. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his blessing, what he immediately did was scholars mention that he made the palace of that king look like glass. So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had a 360 degrees view of what's happening inside the palace. The reason being that there should come no doubt or no suspicion or even the slightest discomfort that something bad could happen to my wife, even though I cannot visibly see what's happening inside. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it as a miracle for Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And what happens inside the palace now? The king, the minute he sees Sarah alayhi salatu wasalam, he reaches, outstretches his hand to touch her. Sarah alayhi salatu wasalam, she being the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, she immediately also turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She prays to Allah, "Ya Allah, don't let any evil come to me from this tyrant." Immediately his hand paralyzes and falls to the side. So he cries out to her saying, "I don't know what magic you're doing upon me, but stop it, I'm not going to harm you. Just pray to whoever you're praying and relieve me of the problem that I'm in." So she prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his hand goes back to normal. But his evil desires, his soul, his nafs does not stop him. He reaches out again the second time. Once again she prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his hand falls to the side. This happens thrice. And the third time he shouts to his soldiers saying, "Why have you brought a witch into my palace? Don't you all know better to do so?" And he tells her, "If you release me of the problem that I am in, I will gift you with a beautiful lady named Hajar alayha salatu wasalam." And she prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his hand goes back to normal and he gives her Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam. Now why I mention this whole story, my dear brothers and sisters, the reason being, see, we cannot see what's happening behind the scenes. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's master plan that is taking place around us. At the outset of this incident, it looks like a tragedy, it looks like a disaster, a problem. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, perhaps, no, he is a great prophet of course, but if we were to put ourselves in his shoes, we would think, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing this to us? But see, what happens is, through this calamity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam. And my dear brothers and sisters, the question I ask you, who is Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he comes to the lineage of Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam. Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam is the mother of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And as we all know, the lineage of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So basically, the union between Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam resulted in our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the greatest thing to ever occur on the face of this earth, for him to come about, for his existence, this union took place after a difficulty, after a calamity. So at the outset, it might look like a tragedy, it might look like a calamity. But in reality, it's something that we need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, I said that even if a disease, even if an affliction, whatever strikes us, we don't know what's happening behind the scenes. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala averted something bigger than that in place of this small difficulty, to which we need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not grumble and not complain. And likewise, from these blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that Allah the Almighty has blessed you and me with an opportunity, with a chance to meet one another. Me, you're all Sri Lankans, but still me coming all the way from Sri Lanka, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan. And why are we meeting here? For no other reason other than the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for that I am extremely grateful unto Allah the Almighty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a sabab, Allah uses reasons. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses Sri Lankan Majlis of Qatar and Brother Sahal and Brother Hazim. For all of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards them. And we hope to meet often also, inshallah ta'ala. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this gathering of us, this small gathering of us. And may He make the angels shroud us with their wings and the sakina, the tranquility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descend upon us. And may Allah the Almighty make high mention of us in the seven heavens. Now see, many a time we say sakina. There's something about sakina. We just say sakina. What is sakina? May the sakina of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sakina, literally you could translate it as tranquility. But sakina, it actually has a much bigger picture to the whole thing about what sakina is. Allah says, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَى رَسُولِهِ وَعَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ in regard to the battle which I've discussed. But many a time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about sakina. Sakina is tranquility, tranquility of heart and peace. But if we were to take the stories of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, all of their stories are filled with incidents, amazing incidents. I'm not going to go in depth, but just look at Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. As a youngster, he plucks up the courage to go and face Batil, to break idols. So where did this courage come from? This is a sakina. His heart was not disturbed. He was not perturbed. Rather, he went calmly. He did whatever he did calmly. And even when they came and questioned him, he used a hikmah to make them understand that these idols have no power whatsoever by saying that, you know, go ask the big guy over there. He's the one who did it. And he wasn't scared. He was opposing his whole community, his own family, his father. But this was the sakina of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tranquility which was in his heart, that gave him the courage to do all of this. Then if you take Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes and meets a tyrant, a dictator. Fir'aun is not someone, you know, you just meet in the streets. He ruled almost like 3/4 of the world at that time, the Pharaoh. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala filled his heart with sakina in a way that he plucked up courage to go and even call him towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, we see the whole army of Fir'aun behind Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the ocean in front of him. His followers are all disturbed. They ask Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, what are we going to do? We are destroyed today. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, very coolly, he strikes the ocean with his staff. And with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ocean divides. From where did this courage come from? From where did this tranquility come from? From the sakina of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, many incidents, even from our own beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's lifetime. And that is also like the battle that I mentioned in the beginning, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Muslims were facing defeat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the angels, almost around 1,000 angels, to help the Muslims in that particular battle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that ayah, he uses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the sakina of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in went into a small slumber in the middle of the battlefield. This was the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu were both in the cave. Gharih, they were in the cave. They were in the cave hiding from the kuffar. They were hiding from the kufr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, ثاني اثنين إذ هما في الغار إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the kuffar, they come close to the cave. This was during the migration from Mecca to Medina. The kuffar are so close to the cave, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, if they were to even just glance downwards, they would see us and we are finished. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calmly advises his companion, لا تحزن. إذ يقول لصاحبه, he tells his friend, his companion, لا تحزن, don't worry. إن الله معنا. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is with us. We may be two, but the third person with us is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't worry. He will look after us. From where did this sakina come from? This is the tranquility we talk about when we say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with his tranquility. Likewise, Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam, youngster, maybe like your age, his brothers, not outsiders, not enemies, his own brothers, they all get together and go and dump him in a well. All of them, they get together and go and dump him into a well. But he is not emotionally disturbed. From the well, he's taken as a slave to an unknown land. He's taken as a slave to an unknown land. In that land, they purchase him and he's made to do, he's under slavery. But still his heart is at rest. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthened him with the sakina, with the tranquility, where he is not worried. Now he grows up in that very house. The mistress of that house, she tries to seduce him. She comes to him and calls him for an evil purpose. See, we need to put ourselves into Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's shoes. He's a slave. This is the mistress of the house calling him. What is stopping him from going? And even so much to the extent that she forces him to engage in the evil act. And scholars mention, my dear brothers and sisters, at that very moment when he was in the room with the lady, the mistress of the house, And when she's calling him to the evil act, he knew that there is no escape, because what the Quran says is that she غلقت الأبواب. You understand? غلق in Arabic is not just أغلق, is to lock. غلق, she double locked all of the doors. And أبواب, not one door. Not باب, أبواب. Many doors. So say perhaps she locked the room door, she locked the front house door, she locked the gate, because she's going to engage in something evil. She would not want to get caught to her husband. So she locks all of these doors, and then comes to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and says, Haythalak. She calls him. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is not a fool. He is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are the most intelligent of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows that all of the doors are locked. He knows that all of the doors are locked. He says, قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, save me from this. Allah forbid, I won't involve myself in this. And the Quran ayah, it goes on to say, اِسْتَبَقَ الْبَابِ. He runs to the door. He knows that the doors are locked. He knows that the doors are locked, and not just normally locked, double bolted. But he runs to the door. What's the purpose of running towards a locked door? What's the purpose of running towards a locked door? If this door is locked, there's no way that we can escape from this room. But he runs straight to the door. Now this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, scholars mentioned that this was the tawakkul that he had in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he knew that if I run away from sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open a way for me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will somehow open a way out for me. Scholars go on to mention that he runs to the door, and the minute his foot strikes the step of the door, the first door opens just like that. A double bolted door, it just opens just like that. He runs to the next door, that door also opens up. And then the third door, fourth door. However many doors were there, all of those doors opened up. And this was because he had the tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He relied that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after all, he's running away from a prohibition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's running away from a sin. He's running to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he knew that Allah will find a way out for him. And the story goes on where she pulls the shirt of his from behind, and that results in her being blamed for the act that she was trying to do. So nevertheless, all of this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, highlight the importance of sakina, the tranquility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with his sakina. So now coming to the topic of today, in regard to having fun in the halal way. See, the thing is, there should not be a misconception about Islam, that Islam is a religion that does not understand a practical life. So rather, Islam is a very balanced religion. Islam is a very balanced religion. And we, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are also a balanced ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, that كَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ, we made you all أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. A balanced nation, a balanced community. So we are balanced, and this ummah is بَيْنَ الْإِفْرَاطِ وَالْتَفْرِيدِ. We are not on either two extremes, but rather we have to always take a moderate stance, and we are in the middle. And Islam, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is a religion which is based on the fitrah. And what is the fitrah? The fitrah is the natural human disposition. In other words, the natural way we are created. We have been engineered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our religion is based on that. So being based on that, we generally and naturally we have a tendency towards having fun. We generally have a tendency towards having fun. You take kids from birth, they have a liking towards toys. They want to play with toys. And as they grow older also, they still like to play with toys. The other day, someone was saying that you don't worry about the age restrictions in toys. You see, toys, they say like this age is from 3 to 14 and 3 to 15. The reason being is even if the child does not play, the father will play with the toys. So, and anyway, when they grow older, then the toys evolve from car toys to bigger toys. And then they like to play around with big cars. And this is how things work. So that's why the ayah that I recited in the beginning also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this hayat al-dunya la'ibun wa lahu. It is play and amusement. It is play and amusement. The reason being, from the time we are born, we're just playing and whiling our lives away. It is a passing mirage. Something that is fake. It is not permanent. It's just a passing mirage. You're involved in different, you see, from small days you have toys and then perhaps your computer games, and then even if you go older and you are into automobiles and you buy a car, a new model comes out and then that model becomes obsolete. This is how things go. You're into technology. You take the latest iPad or the latest iPhone. Of course, in another few months, something else is going to come out. We all know inevitably iPhone 6 is going to come out, and then the iPhone 5S is going to become obsolete, and then the Note 4 and the Note 5, and I don't know how many notes are going to come out. This is the way the life of this dunya goes on. Something new keeps on coming up, and the one which is older becomes obsolete. So, laibun wa lahw. It is a fake and passing mirage that we should not be fooled. So, but nevertheless, Islam, like I said in the beginning, is a balanced religion. It teaches us balance. And this is also from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we were talking about the mercy of Allah in the beginning. Allah says in Surah Ar-Rahman, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He raised the heavens, وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ. Allahu Akbar. This is indeed a great mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ. And we place the balance of things. And when we say balance, we don't necessarily, okay, the main meaning is justice. Justice. This ummah is based on justice. Islam is a religion based on justice. But in other words, even other, the balance of other things too. The balance of, you take any profession, for example, you are a teacher. Okay, this is a classroom and I'm a teacher, for example. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a balance where I know, like say the students are from this age to this age group, then I know what I need to teach them. I can't exceed that balance and go and start teaching them astronomy or something, you know, complex which they won't understand at that particular age. Likewise, say I'm doing a lecture now, I should have the understanding of the balance as to how long I need to continue this lecture and not bore you all to death. You see, and you take a doctor, he would know the balance of, you know, how much of milligrams, the antibiotics I need to prescribe to my patient. You take anything, any trade, for example, for anything around the world. You say a builder, he knows the balance of how to build. You say a martial artist, he knows the balance of how he should place his feet and how he should place his hand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept a balance in every single thing. Every single thing. A lady, perhaps she knows the balance in cooking, you know, how much salt you need to put. Gradually, as she becomes a good cook, she won't even need the measuring cups and stuff like that. She would just sprinkle and she would know the balance. Naturally. So this is the balance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept a balance in every single thing. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps a balance in things like sprinkling salt in your food and stuff like that, what about the religion by itself? Which is the most important thing. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the thing, Allah would keep His balance the best. So in that, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we see the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So many beautiful instances where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has had light moments, humorous moments. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has cracked jokes. And when you see, sometimes in some parts of, you see, you're reading history or you're reading the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, please, the youngsters especially, don't come to a conclusion that the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all strict and stern. Or the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is strict and stern. Don't do this, don't do this. No! Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he interacted with his sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, he interacted with them in such a beautiful manner, with his own wives. Why, there is even an instance where once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his beloved wife, Aisha radiallahu anha, they were traveling. They were traveling, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked Aisha radiallahu anha, now Rasulullah does not need to do this. But he asks, he being the Prophet of Allah, he asked Aisha radiallahu anha, Ya Aisha, how about a race? How about a race? Now say, I'm just saying that the thing that today what people think is, now if I were to call your brother and say, come on, let's race outside on the road, Sheikh, you're going to race. I say, a big scholar calls you, come on, let's go race. This is not how we picture the scholars. We think, you know, they should be all prim and proper and bearded purse people, you know, they should not laugh, they should not joke. No, this is not how Islam is. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asks Aisha radiallahu anha, how about a race? And she says, okay, fine, let's have a race. Of course, why not? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Aisha radiallahu anha, they run. They run a race. And who wins? Aisha radiallahu anha, she wins the race. The reason being, this was at the beginning of their marriage. Aisha radiallahu anha, she wins the race. And she says, see, I won the race. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not comment. He just kept quiet. He accepted defeat. After some time, later on, again, in another place, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he asked her, Aisha radiallahu anha, suddenly, just out of the blue, how about a race? Yeah, of course, I beat you the last time. Come on, let's run again. It's no big deal. Aisha radiallahu anha and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam run again. And this time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wins. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, you know, then now see, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he highlights, you know, Aisha radiallahu anha, you put on some weight. You put on some weight after the years of marriage, that's why I beat you. So see, in this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was observing her. He knew when now she beat him, of course. Perhaps she must have been a fast runner in the first place. So he was waiting for her, now he observed, okay, she's put on weight now, now I'll be able to beat her. And then he challenged her. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do this. Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, once there was an incident, they were all seated together, they were eating melon. You know, say perhaps watermelon. After eating the watermelon, they started, you know, the skin of the watermelon, they started pelting it and throwing it at one another. And one of those melons knocked Abu Huraira radiallahu an, and he was rolling on the floor, doubling with laughter. Abu Huraira radiallahu an, and you see Abu Huraira, oh. We all, you know, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. You can't even picture him rolling on the floor, doubling with laughter. But this is a Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the marketplace. There was a person, before that, once a lady came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked her, hey, are you the one who is married to the guy with whiteness in his eyes? And she was upset. She goes to her husband and asks her, have you got whiteness in your eyes? She says, lady, every man has got whiteness in his eyes. Everyone has got white in his eyes. And then she understands that. Because, you know, she took everything of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so serious that when he said white, she thought perhaps the black horse has become white, completely white. So he goes and asks her husband. He says, everybody has white. What's the problem? Another lady comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulullah, old lady. She comes, an auntie. She comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulullah, will I go to Jannah? No, I'm sorry, but sadly you won't go to Jannah. She starts weeping. Why? Because she took the statement of Rasulullah so serious. She starts crying. The Rasulullah stops her. Oh, don't worry. What I was saying is, you won't go as an old lady, rather you'll become a young lady and then you will go to Jannah. She goes back laughing and smiling. So this was the humor, this was the light notes of Rasulullah. Another instance, he goes to the marketplace. In the marketplace, now there was a person named Rukana. There was a person named Rukana. Now he is a person like perhaps Batista. Don't go and watch wrestling. I don't advocate. I was just reading about it. So he was the all Arab champion, wrestling champion, Rukana, his name. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now goes to the market and he sees Rukana. He sees Rukana. Rukana knows that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of Allah is here, but now he is the all Arab champion. He doesn't want to acknowledge Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But see, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the best da'i. He was the best caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a responsibility upon us too. There are so many lessons to be derived from the story. He goes to Rukana. Now, even though Rukana did not acknowledge, he goes to Rukana and says, Rukana, I have something amazing to tell you. Will you spare some time to listen to me? Rukana looks at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, okay, fine, you know, I'm a very busy person, but I'll give you some time if we have a wrestling match and if you win. I'll listen to you if you win. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepts the challenge. He says, okay, fine, let's go for it. Now it's a marketplace. Now some people gather and now, you know, they have this. They have they used to have wrestling where all of them used to gather, a crowd used to gather and, you know, cheer them on and all these things. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, fine. Rukana, all Arab champion, alright? Wrestling champion. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not we don't know of him as a wrestling champion. So the match begins. They take their positions and then you have perhaps a referee or an umpire or whatever it is in the middle and then he counts at 1, 2, 3, let's go. Then the match begins. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes Rukana, body slams him and pins him down to the ground. Round one, Rukana taps out. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wins round one. Now he did not say 3 rounds. He just said, you beat me once and I'll listen to you. But then he says, you know, he's upset now. He's the all Arab champion and now Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has beat me. Give me another chance. Okay, fine. Round two. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pins him down again. Round three. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pins him down again. And finally, Rukana gets up after all three rounds and says, you know what? I'm amazed. Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'm amazed. I am the Arab champion, but how come? Thrice you pin me down? How is it possible? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then looks at Rukana and smiles and says, Rukana, do you want to know something more amazing? And then he gives him the message of Islam. You know what Rukana does? Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. See, this is the beauty of the da'wah. It's not that, you know, each time you want to go and give da'wah, you start off, you know, preaching or a khutbah there. No, rather you should udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'idati al hasana, with hikmah, with wisdom. You need to come down to each person's level. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's a wrestler. So this would be the thing that would intrigue him and incite him towards listening to me. So he accepted the challenge with the help of Allah. And anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an extremely strong individual. So he beat Rukana, and by that Rukana comes into the fold of Islam. So likewise, my dear brothers and sisters, there are so many incidents in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself where he used to joke around with the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in within the framework, within the guidelines of Sharia. There was once a Sahabi, his name was Zahir radiallahu anhu. He was a Bedouin from the outskirts of Medina. He was not from the city, like you say. He was from the outside. He was a villager basically. So he used to come, and he was not a good looking Sahabi radiallahu anhu. But whenever he comes to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to bring gifts for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever he comes to see him, something from the village, perhaps, you know, whatever it may be, some food item, whatever. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved him dearly. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes to the marketplace, and Zahir is selling some things in the market. He's a stall or a shop or whatever, he's selling some things in the market. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quietly, now see, the thing is, we need to, when we read these narrations, it's not just about having a good laugh, but you should understand that why should Rasulullah, the Prophet of Allah, do all of this? He could just be strict and stern. But see, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he hides and goes behind Zahir, and he catches Zahir radiallahu anhu like this, and he carries Zahir radiallahu anhu from behind. He carries Zahir radiallahu anhu from behind. And then he cries out, who is ready to buy this slave? Who is ready to buy this slave? Zahir radiallahu anhu, now he's struggling. Who is this, trying to catch me? And he turns and he spots Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The minute he knew that it was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he relaxed. He relaxed and he let Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do what he was doing. But then he said, ya Rasulullah, no one is going to buy me because I am an ugly person. I am not so handsome. And even if someone were to buy me, they would face a loss because I won't even fit as a slave. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he jokes back saying, ya Zahir, that's your opinion of yourself, but in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sight of the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are rabih, you are extremely valuable, you're extremely profitable. Allahu Akbar. His heart, Zahir radiallahu anhu, was so happy by this action of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, we discuss the story of Rukana. So all of these instances in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, life of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, highlight the beauty of Islam. For when we look at Islam in this aspect, through these shades, we see that Islam is a religion which is balanced. You have all sides to it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, now we'll just discuss the things that are, I mean, the types of entertainment that is halal in Islam, and there you see that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged most of them. But before we go into that, a few things. Today, what are the types of entertainment today that we have around in the world? Primarily, you could say, people spend their time doing what? Music. You see, music has become part and parcel of everyone's day-to-day life. You go to the malls, you go to the coffee shops, the restaurants, wherever you go, you have music. Music. See, music is so harmful that it grows the tree of hypocrisy within your hearts. The hypocrisy, the tree of nifaq grows within your hearts. The reason being, what we need to understand, whatever Islam has prohibited us, the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, generally, most of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited them due to them having an extreme harm upon the Muslim ummah, or in general upon the human race. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and now people are finding out. Like for example, you take the meat of the pig, the pork and all of these, there is so much of bacteria, so much of germs in those meat. Likewise, if you were to take the other, gambling, intoxicants, all of these things are harmful to mankind. Gambling, you lose all of your money. Some people go in rich and they even give in their cars and their wives and their houses and they come out bankrupt when they go gambling. Sometimes you go in, you come out rich, but most of the time you're going to come out penniless. You take intoxicants, once you had a bottle, you don't know what you're saying, you don't know what you're talking about. You may even hit your own brother, your own parents, your own relatives because you're drunk. You don't know what you're doing. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what harms mankind in general are all prohibited. So music likewise has so much of ill effects. Many a time we see that subliminal messages and all of these things are being passed through. Yes, true, whether they be hidden or not, most of today's music is all based about that, you know, you live only once, do whatever you're doing, and so much of obscene material in those songs. All of these things are encrypted within our brains. And that's what results in youngsters becoming stubborn, becoming, you know, this nature of theirs that they're not willing to listen to anybody, that they want to do, you know, because we only live once and we have to do whatever it is and party all the time. These are the messages that are passed through these evil songs. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has highlighted that the tree of nifaq grows the more you listen. You won't realize it. You won't realize it. But that gradually you start enjoying music, you start playing it in your car, you like the bump when you're driving in your car, because you're starting to like it and you move further and further away from the religion. That brings about nifaq, where you go to the masjid, you pray, you involve in different things, but in your heart you're a munafiq, because you know you're not true. You listen to all that is evil, that makes you two-faced. One face that looks like a religious Muslim, and the other side full of evil. And before we go on, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, an important thing to be mentioned, where I mentioned that Islam is a religion that is balanced, that is highlighted in the beautiful hadith of Hanzala radiallahu anhu. It's a very short hadith where Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu meets Hanzala radiallahu anhu somewhere in the market area. And he asks Hanzala radiallahu anhu, "Ya Hanzala, how are you?" or something like that. Hanzala radiallahu anhu is very upset. He is very upset and then he says, "Nafaqa Hanzala." As I was talking about nifaq, that's why I remembered this. He says, "Nafaqa Hanzala." Hanzala has become a munafiq. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu says, "Ya Hanzala, what are you talking about? How can you be a munafiq? You're from the ashab of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're from the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Hanzala radiallahu anhu, he says, "Yes, I am from the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why I'm talking about this, that's why I'm saying this. Because whenever I'm with Rasulullah, whenever I'm with the Prophet of Allah, when he talks about Jannah, when he talks about Jahannam, my heart soars, my iman rises. And it is as if I see Jannah in front of me. My eyes flow with tears. My heart is filled with so much of iman. But the minute I come out from the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I go home to my wives and my children, I become engrossed with dunya. My iman reduces, fluctuates. What's happening? That's why I feel I'm two-faced. When I go there, I'm one thing, and when I come back home, I'm another thing. So how is this happening? Naturally, I feel that this is a trait of hypocrisy. He explains to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu says, "Ya Alhamdulillah, if you're saying that, then I also have to say the very same thing, because I'm in the same boat with you, Allahu Akbar. I'm in the same boat with you." So then both of them go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to clarify this. They go and inform Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, whenever we are with you, our iman is soaring, we are as if we are in the heavens. When we go home, we become a totally another person. What is this? Why is this happening?" Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very beautifully clarifies, many brothers and sisters. He says, "Walladhi nafsi biyadihi law tazumuna ala al-hali allati takununa biha indi." He says, "By the one whose hand is my soul in, if y'all were to be in the same situation of iman, in the same level of iman as y'all are when y'all are with me 24/7, if y'all always remain on that stage, لَصَافَعَتْكُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ عَلَى فُرُسِكُمْ وَتُرُقَاتِكُمْ Allahu Akbar. عَلَى فُرُسِكُمْ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you stay in that same level of iman, the malaika would come down to earth and start handshaking with you. They would greet you whilst you all are reclining on your beds and also whilst you're walking on the streets. Allahu Akbar. If you all remain in the same level of iman. But then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, you're a man, you're a human being, وَلَكِنْ سَاعَةً وَسَاعَةً. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, scholars go on to clarify, sa'atan lillah li rabbik wa sa'atan li qalbik. An hour for Allah, an hour for yourself. An hour for Allah, an hour for yourself. Your iman fluctuates. The iman of the anbiya keep on soaring. They never come down. The iman of the malaika are stationary. They don't go up, they don't go down. The highest level, they're just there. So that's why they can, their whole life, they're ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah has created human beings, us, in a manner that our iman fluctuates and comes down. You see, at times you hear a good lecture, an inspiring lecture, and you're totally motivated. You want to come home and start praying 1,000 rak'ah salah. The reason being your iman is charged like over 100%. But then the very next day, perhaps you won't make fajr salah. The reason being your iman drops. And that's why they say the consistency, istiqama, is very important. So iman is something that fluctuates, goes up and down. The thing I want to highlight is sa'atan lillah wa sa'atan rabbik. Because we human beings, after some time we get tired. We need something else. And that's why the scholars say that rather than praying 1,000 rak'ah, say 100 rak'ah for a day, that you start off with 2 rak'ahs a day, and then gradually you stay on for 5-6 months with 2 rak'ahs, and then you gradually increase in such a manner that you have istiqama. You have istiqama. And don't just go one shot to 100 and then come back to zero. And sa'ata lillah wa sa'ata li rabbik. 1 hour for Allah, it doesn't literally mean just 1 hour in the sense 60 minutes. But he says, a time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a time for yourself. Where you need to give time to yourself, where you need to relax. You don't have to be in sajidah the whole day. You relax, you spend some, you have entertainment, you enjoy yourself within the frameworks of sharia. This is the thing highlighted in the hadith of Hamdala radiyallahu anha. And also, Hamdala radiyallahu anha. And also there are a few other things like, I think the audience is not suitable for that, but it's just about, you see, what the youth are involved in today, such as, you know, all filth you see around the drug abuse, and where you see they're so addicted to these all addictions. Addictions, the reason being, they're not happy with their own lives, they're looking for happiness somewhere else. But if you turn to the, I always say this, like, the minute you do a sin, right after the sin, you feel you regret so much and you're so guilty that you are disgusted by yourself. You go and look at the mirror and you're disgusted. You're disgusted. You don't even want to look at yourself, whatever it may be. There are so many types of addiction. You take drugs, you take pornography, there are so many types of addictions. All of these addictions, the more they are fueled, the more, you see, it leads one thing after the other, goes on to zina, goes on to intoxicant. You start falling to different pits of sins. The reason being, you're not really found happiness. You're not really found happiness, and the happiness can only be found in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and also I just wanted to talk about, like, many of the youngsters today, wild time away in coffee shops and all of these things, and you have the habits of shisha and all of these things over here, all of which are so harmful, so bad to one's health. They say that these things are cancerous, so cancerous that much worse than even cigarettes. Some concentrated types of the shisha, one puff is equivalent to almost around 5 cigarettes. So all of these things are harmful to your health. And we know that health is wealth. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith implied the importance of the health in saying, as you know, اِتَّنِمْ خَمْسًا قَبْلَ خَمْسًا. Take hold of 5 things before 5 things overtake you. And one of those is your health before sickness overtakes you. And your life before death overtakes you. So we need to use the good health that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with to live a fruitful life, a productive life that would bless us in this world and the hereafter, where we would attain success in this world and the hereafter. So now next we will just discuss a few halal entertainment as to what we could involve ourselves in. When we're talking about halal entertainment, like I said just a few seconds ago, it needs to be productive. It needs to be productive, at least benefit us in this world, and likewise the hereafter, or at least the minimum benefit us in this world. Benefit us in this world by giving us a sense of relaxation, you know, letting off the steam of stress, and also, strengthening our body and all of these things. From those are sports. You have different types of sports. And you see, what we need to understand is, in general, everything is permissible. Everything is permissible except for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. We don't say everything is prohibited except for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made permissible. No. We say everything is permissible except for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. The prohibitions, you can count them. The permissibility is general. Everything is permissible except what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. So any sport, you take it within the framework of Sharia, and then you can come to a conclusion whether it's permissible or not. Whether you're exposing your awrah. Whether, you see, swimming is advised, and one of the things that I want to highlight. But is it permissible to go to swim in a bikini, or is it permissible to swim whilst you're not covering yourself properly? No, haram. If you're exposing your awrah for males, it is from your navel to your knees. If you're not covered that much, you can't go and involve yourself in swimming. You will be sinning rather than swimming. So, likewise, every single type of entertainment, we match it to the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with that we come to a conclusion whether it's halal or haram. So, sports. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, Al-mu'minu al-qawiyu ahabu inda Allahi min al-mu'min al-da'if. A strong believer, a strong and healthy mu'min is more dearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a weak mu'min. Mu'minun in general are beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there's a slight difference between a strong, healthy believer and a weak believer. Because a strong, healthy believer is more productive to himself, to his society, to the community, and to the deen at large. The things that he can bring about him being healthy and strong are more productive. So to be healthy, you can't just be a couch potato in one place and call yourself healthy. Rather, you need to move around. Blood needs to circulate. You need to be involved in sports. And from these sports, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, comes, you can say, like we discussed the hadith of Ruqana, wrestling is permitted. Wrestling is permitted, but don't go and wrestle with your underclothes. But rather, wear proper clothing. Because you see, all these the things of wrestling and all these WWF and WWE and all of these are filled with obscene material that none of us can view. All of them are half naked. So I'm not talking about that wrestling, but generally I'll say martial arts, for example. Martial arts, now see, we know that it's prohibited to beat a person's face. You cannot beat a person's face. It's haram in Islam. So boxing is not allowed because you go and mutilate your face. You're just beating one another's faces. You come out with the teeth and nose and everything broken. You see, boxers in general, their noses are broken because they're beaten to death. So boxing is not allowed. When you take martial arts, you have different types of martial arts. Kung Fu, you have Karate, you have Tai Chi, you have different, I don't know, all of these names. Which would teach you discipline, balance, and whatever is within the framework of the Sharia, the guidelines of Sharia, it is advisable because it teaches you self-defense. It teaches you self-defense and also keeps you healthy. And from these, like I said, wrestling. And then we have swimming and horse riding. Swimming and horse riding. Now, why I am coupling these two is because there are two or three ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam which talks about swimming and horse riding. But I don't want to mention those ahadith because according to some of the scholars of Islam, those ahadith are da'if. Those ahadith are da'if. And two or three of them, Imam Albani rahimahullah, he goes on to say that they're da'if jidd and they're very weak. So we don't mention them, but still we have to acknowledge that there are ahadith talking about swimming and horse riding. So even though they be weak, there is a possibility that they could be authentic. And it is from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then after all, it is not inciting us towards bid'ah or to something bad. It is talking about something good. For swimming is extremely good for your body. It is the only sport that conditions your whole body. Any other sport, perhaps you're working on your hands or your legs. But swimming, it your respiratory system, your lungs, your breathing, you're involving your whole body. And it's not easy, trust me, it's not easy. You can't swim 10 laps, you'll be panting, unless you are a good swimmer. So swimming is good. Swimming is good and it's been encouraged in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like I said, but I don't want to mention them because they are da'if. And likewise, horse riding. Horse riding is also something that has been encouraged by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the next thing is archery. Archery has been encouraged a lot by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this hadith is in Bukhari. This hadith is in Bukhari, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was passing a crowd of people practicing archery, and he addresses them saying, "Ya, O Bani Ismail, O the children of Ismail." He is also from the children of Ismail. He tells them, "Practice archery. Practice archery, for your father Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam was an archer." Was an archer. The scholars of Islam, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, go on to talk about archery. Archery is such a good sport that there are so many benefits attached to it. Number one, a few things that I would like to share with you. In archery, you have to control your emotions. You need to control your emotions. Say you're aiming, you've got a bout of happiness or a bout of sadness, and then you won't be able to aim properly. It teaches you control of emotions. It teaches you precision. You need to aim accurately. You need to aim accurately, and gradually perhaps You have the bullseye. You have the bullseye, and the first time, if any of you were given a bow and an arrow, perhaps the arrow won't even hit the bullseye, it'll go out of the bullseye. But gradually you grow closer, closer, closer to the red dot in the middle of the target. And once your aim is perfected, the precision is perfect and you're accurate, you shoot to the point. So this teaches you accuracy and also discipline. It also teaches you commitment and consistency, istiqama basically, istiqama. Because the more you try to become accurate, it's not easy. In the second, third arrow, you're not going to hit the red dot in the middle. It's after perhaps 10, 20, 50 cues of arrows, bunches of arrows, only then will you hit the target. So it teaches you istiqama. So it is a sport that develops skills, develops different skills in you. And this is why it has been encouraged by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in regard to the great outdoors, the great outdoors. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with such a beautiful natural environment around us. Hey, brothers over here, you'll have the deserts where you can go desert camping, and then you're in Sri Lanka, you have, mashallah, so many places to visit. So much of camping to be done, where you can go and see the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also permitted in Islam, of course. There's nothing that would stop it, where we could go out and expose yourself to the natural outdoors, the environment, and this is also from the halal entertainment, going out. So another thing breaks out from here as video games. Video games. Why? The reason being, everyone today is involved in video games, aren't you all? Everyone is involved in video games. So what do the scholars of Islam say about video games? What does Islam generally say about video games? See, the thing is, like I said in the beginning, you need to be productive. You don't see any productivity in video games. You become a couch potato. You're just seated in one place and playing games. The only exercise you get is perhaps your thumbs becoming stronger. That's about it. You're not doing any other exercise. So, but still, as it has become a norm today, everybody plays. You've got games on your iPad, you've got games on your phones, you've got games on your computers. What does Islam say about it? Once again, we match it to the guidelines of Sharia. We match it to the guidelines of Sharia, and we don't become addicted to games where we never go out and we miss our salawat from Fajr till Isha. Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha is on the same game, on the same level. No, rather you can spend some time on games. It's not haram, as long as those games don't contain any explicit material, obscene material, which is not permissible to view. Such as what? Grand Theft Auto. And games of that nature. All of those games which have obscene material, explicit material in them, we avoid them. We avoid them, we don't play. But then you have something like perhaps basketball or some other game which is okay, or cricket or whatever it may be. You can involve yourself as long as you don't get addicted to it to the extent where you miss your salawat and you don't even know what's happening around you. The whole house falls down and you're still on the game. You don't know what's happening around you. Allah save us all. So, the next thing is an alternative to music. Some people are so addicted to music, the minute he enters the car, it has to blast. He can't drive, you know, he feels bored, he feels uncomfortable to drive without music, he needs the beat. Some people are generally addicted also. You've got your Beats headsets and Beats or Dr. Dre headsets, all of these things. Your iPod and your iPhone, you've got music libraries for so many GB. So how do you come out of it? The best alternative, my dear brothers and sisters, is switch to nasheeds. Switch to nasheeds. Because if you're addicted to music and you can't come out of it and you can't bear the silence is so deafening, then switch to nasheeds. Nasheeds, you see today we have nasheeds which are almost similar to music. So I'm not asking you to switch to nasheeds which are similar to music. Rather switch to nasheeds which are free of music. And you have many nasheeds, beautiful nasheeds today. Alhamdulillah, albums of nasheeds which are free of music. Where you can, it's permissible, it's allowed, it's halal to listen to them. And gradually you come out of the evil addiction of music. So that's also fine. And then the next and the most main thing is hanging out with the right crowd. Because today all of us, we have friends. And our friends define who we are. Our friends define who we are. For example, if you are hanging out with the guys who are on crack and marijuana and ganja and all of these things, then you're also going to be, maybe perhaps you're a saint, but you're going to be termed as part of them because they are your friends and they define who you are. So if you're with the right company, and also Allah forbid, they may pull you into the trap or into the pit of drug addiction. For if you are with a person who sells perfume, what happens? At least you smell nice. Even though you may not spray perfume on you, you smell nice. But if you spend time with a blacksmith, there is a chance that you might get yourself burnt. So the company affects the people around them. And it defines who you are and also gives a picture of what type of a person you are. So choose the right friends, the right crowd, and the minute you see that those friends are going away, it's your responsibility, as the responsibility of da'wah, to advise them and call them, and if they're not going to listen, don't stay with them. Move away, choose right friends and spend time with them. And also don't while time away, rather keep good company. That is also from the halal entertainment, as what we would do as human beings. Social interaction is very important. And the next is marriage, but I don't think many people would agree with that. It's just on the lighter side of it. But marriage is also from the halal entertainment. Because we see many instances where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had so many light moments with his beloved wives, radiallahu anha, such as Aisha radiallahu anha and all that. And you have all of these, you see, you can't go camping alone. Perhaps you could go with your friends, or you had to go with your family, with your wives and your kids. So in this way, you spend some time, you spend time with your kids. You know, like the other day, the brother was saying that, it's you know, your kids need your presence more than your presence. They need your presence with the CE and more than your presence in the sense of gifts. They need your presence, they need you. They need you with them. You need to spend time with them. It's not about giving money, giving them credit cards or giving them whatever they want. Okay, he wants a PS4, PS5, PS6, you buy whatever it is and you're never with him. You're never with him to understand him, to know what he's going through, to see how he's growing up. Now you spend time with him. And the best way is to spend time in such a way where you go out, and okay, you can also go out to eat. Eating out, it's also from the halal types of entertainment, where you can go out and spend time with your family. And finally, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it doesn't necessarily have to be about sports. It doesn't necessarily have to be about video games. You could also relax with a good book in your hand. With a good book in your hand. You could just pick a book. Many people, I myself, I'm a very avid reader, and people who read would understand that when you read, alhamdulillah, you practically go into the book. You're in another world. You're in another world. It's a total sense of relaxation. So, well, the thing is, in regard to books too, now what are the types of books you're going to read? Harry Potter, fairy tales, yeah, I know, those are very interesting. But the thing is, after all, they're all fake and false, just like how movies are. Nothing is true. But still, you can read books that do not contain any obscene material, like I said before. We match it to the Sharia, of course. But gradually, from those books, we switch to more beneficent books. And then, more or less, more on to Islamic books, where we read about the history of Islam, about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Books that would increase your level of education. That's what I'm trying to highlight. It doesn't necessarily have to be only Islamic books. You're going to be like, how many times am I going to read the Islamic history? Alright, so other than that, you could read books that would help you, which increase your education. And not fables and fairy tales, which are all false. So reading is also part of the halal entertainment in Islam. So with that, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we conclude. And we also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of us and help us to stay away from that which is haram. Because the other day when I was doing a lecture about the signs of the day of Qiyamah, I mentioned that whilst I was doing my research for the lecture, minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, major signs of the day of Qiyamah. The minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, the list is endless, but still, all of those, most of them, 99% of the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah have taken place. That's a scary fact. Minor signs of the day of Qiyamah have taken place. And all that is remaining are the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said along the lines of these words, that the major signs of the day of Qiyamah are like a beaded necklace. A necklace with beads. If one bead were to break off the necklace, what would happen? The remaining beads would fall one after the other. And this is the example given to the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. If even one were to occur, from them, what are they? Dajjal, the sun rising from the west, Allah save us all, the door of Tawbah would be shut. Like this, many of the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, even if one were to occur, the remaining 10 would occur one after the other consecutively, just like that, just like how the beads fall. So like I said, minor signs, most of them have taken place. All that is remaining are rather few of the minor signs, and then the major signs. And from them, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the sign Dajjal. Dajjal. The other day I posted a status saying that the society, the ummah at large, or the human race of the world, is being conditioned for the arrival of Dajjal. Dajjal is about to emerge. We know that Dajjal is alive. Dajjal is alive, stuck in some island somewhere, Allah knows where. He is going to emerge when the decree of Allah falls, and the time is very close. And the ummah at large, the world, is being conditioned for his arrival. His mention is less.
The ulama, the scholars are not talking about him. This is also from the science. The less his mention is made on the manabir, on the pulpits of the masajid, this is the time when Dajjal would break out. When was the last time you heard a khutbah about Dajjal or a lecture about Dajjal? People are forgetting about Dajjal, but he is an evil reality who is lurking behind the scenes just there in that island. The less his mention is made, he would come out and his trial, Allahu Akbar. The hadith of Rasulullah from the time, from the creation of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam until the day of Qiyamah, there is no greater trial than the trial of Dajjal. His trials are so great and you would need the two or three lectures to cover all of it. And anyway, we have done some lectures on them which are available online regarding the trials of Dajjal. But what I'm trying to say is, the question that we need to ask ourselves, are we in any way part of the welcoming committee of Dajjal? Are we in any way, knowingly or unknowingly, part of the welcoming committee of Dajjal? Allah save us all. Allah save us all. And most of these entertainment today, the world is introducing to us, all traps of Dajjal. All traps of Dajjal. To incite us and pull us and make us ignorant of the fact, to keep us busy. To keep us busy and away from our goal. As we know, this life that we are traversing on is headed to Akhirah. That is our destination, that is our objective. All of these entertainment are meant to make you miss Salah. Make you a weak believer, gradually a weak Muslim, and then even Allah save, away from the fold of Islam. Allah save us all. This is the agenda of the Kuffar. That's what they are planning. That's what they are planning. And we ourselves, the strong believers, we need to be clever, intelligent, understand the traps of shaitan and stay away from all that is haram. So with that we conclude. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of us and help us to act upon that which is good, and also forgive all of our sins and accept all of our deeds. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us another chance to meet once again. And just as how He united us today, may Allah the Almighty unite us in the gardens of Jannah. With that I conclude. Wa akhir da'wah, alhamdulillah.